of sherry.
Hi, this is Arlene and you're listening to Durian ASEAN. Today in our ABC dialogue, we have a guest. His name is actually very long. His name is Tunku Zain Al-Abidin Ibnu Tuanku Mukris. He's a prince from Negeri Sembilan as well as the founding president of IDEAS. He will be discussing with us on the role of monarchy in modern Malaysia. Welcome.
Morning.
Hi. So the first question, this is related to monarchy. So what is the historical relevance and context of monarchy rule in the Malay heartland?
Well, I think the concept of monarchy in the region, not just in what is now Malaysia, it goes back millennia. I think especially our monarchy is probably the oldest institution that is still recognized by our political system. It predates Merdeka by, as I say, millennia. It predates the coming of Islam. So the institution of monarchy has been here longer than any
other.
But
how does it started, like in the beginning?
Okay. I think
the idea of monarchy in this region.
I would imagine it's not so different from how monarchies developed in many other parts of the world. I don't think any historian will be able to tell you a definitive point in the past when this is the first monarchy in Southeast Asia. So, but I would say that. Certainly, the Malacca myth that this was the founding sultanate of the region, or is I think sometimes exaggerated. I mean, even in
there are a few other kingdoms throughout this region, isn't it? For example, the Kedah.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Kedah was a sultanate in 1136. So, and it was a Hindu monarchy well before that, and that's. That's if you look only at Kedah. But of course, before Kedah existed, before any of the other kingdoms existed, they were, you had Sriwijaya, you had Majapahit, you had in Sumatra the Malayu kingdom, also predates any of the polities that we have in the peninsula. So, the origins of monarchy in Southeast Asia are, and of course you have all the kingdoms in the northern side of Southeast Asia today as well. So I think it's very difficult to pinpoint a precise.
I mean, there's a lot of, if I'm not mistaken, according to my own historical knowledge, there's a lot of. Wars happening between different areas throughout Southeast Asia, and having a kingdom sort of like the king will protect the interests of the people.
Yeah, quite right.
And at the same time, the people will have to give their allegiance towards the king.
Which is probably how monarchies developed in every single other part of the world, really. So I think the question is how. I think the question for political scientists today is how those. Ancient origin, from those ancient beginnings, how did the institution develop to become what it is today? And what is, what meaning do all traditional institutions have for people today? I think that's the question for political scientists. Mm-hmm. But as I say, no historian, I think, will be able to tell you an exact moment in time when the first monarchy in Southeast Asia was. Came into being.
But to put a focus on the Negeri Sembilan monarchy, which is probably different from the other monarchies in the peninsula of Malaysia, how can you describe
it? I would say that every monarchy, every polity developed in its own unique way throughout history. I know that many people now seem to think that the monarchy, the system in Negeri Sembilan is very different from the others, and to an extent that's true, but that doesn't mean that all the others are the same as well. I think the system in Terengganu is slightly different from the system in Pahang in the south and Kelantan in the north. right? So I think it's not just it's not fair to just focus on this idea that Negeri Sembilan is very different, although we are.
I was watching a documentary, I think it was a few years back, on how interesting or how unique it was the way the monarchy in Negeri Sembilan choose.
Yeah. So this is actually on Discovery Channel, and this was a documentary that was done in conjunction with the installation of Tuanku Muhriez, my father, as the 11th Yang Diputuan Besar of Negeri Sembilan. And yes, one of the themes of that show was to highlight the method of succession, unlike other states where there's a clear there's a clear line of succession.
Yeah.
In Negeri Sembilan, it's always we've had the system of the undangs, who, and it's they who elect the ruler out of the royal family. So, and this the history of this is fascinating. I mean, first you have to understand the institution of the undangs. You know, they were the lawgivers, the undangs, or the four major chiefs of Negeri Sembilan, who over time acquired the privilege of electing the ruler. And this was actually a system of power sharing, because, I mean, for a long time, Minangkabau migrants had crossed the peninsula from Sumatra to the peninsula, and they brought with them the socio-political structures that they had in Pagaruyung. And amongst these institutions, amongst these structures, were the system of sort of stepped pyramidal democracy, in which local villagers would elect their head, and all the village heads would elect the district head, and so on and so forth, until you came to the undangs. They had an agreement with the sultans of Johor, but in terms of ensuring their protection. But over time, particularly with the coming of the Dutch, and then contestations in Malacca, you had the Bugis in the north in Selangor, and so the protection that Johor offered to the Minangkabau people was, you know, sort of broke down, and so the undangs, the chiefs, decided to invite a ruler from Pagaruyung, the home dynasty, the home, the motherland, as it were, to come and cross the straits and become the Raja. Mm-hmm. And that's how Raja Malewa came to be the Yam Tuan, the Yang Diputuan Besar of Negeri Sembilan, by 1773. I mean, again, the exact date, 1773, has been contested. But certainly by 1773, a new federal government had been created in Negeri Sembilan, and it was headed by Raja Malewa. He passed away, and then the undangs came together and invited a prince from Pagaruyung, who sent Raja Hitam. He passed away, and then they convened again and invited another prince by the name of Raja Lenggang. And after him, this is where it gets very interesting, because by the time Raja Lenggang passed away, there had been a major civil war in Pagaruyung, and most of the royal family had been killed. This is the Padri War, which is a civil war between an Adat faction and a Padri faction. I mean, basically, I mean, to simplify it in today's term, this is the early 19th century.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to put it in today's terms, it was basically people who wanted to preserve their culture and traditions versus religious fundamentalists. I mean, that would be a simplistic way of.
So in the 19th century, also they have this problem of religious fundamentalists.
Well, and many parallels, because many of the those in the Padri faction were people who had come back from the Middle East.
Ah,
And they came back to Pagaruyung, and their view was, you know, all this the traditions and the adat were in conflict with what they now understood to be true Islam, and so they took up arms against the establishment that were the custodians of this adat.
So what happened after that?
Well, what happened in Pagaruyung was that most of the royal family was killed. I think the Minangkabau polity there was severely, it lost its prestige. But what it meant for us in Negeri Sembilan is that the Undangs could no longer invite someone from Pagaruyung. So for the first time, they chose one of Raja Lenggang's sons, or they rather confirmed that Raja Radin would be to be the next Yam Tuan. And since then, the tradition of the Undangs electing the ruler has survived, and it survived right up till the day. But one thing I didn't mention just now is the fact that I mentioned briefly the concept of power sharing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because all the undangs, we have the system of the sukus, right? And
mm-hmm.
All the undangs come from the suku Biduanda. And the suku Biduanda was formed out of an alliance, the intermarriages between the original Minangkabau migrants with the Orang Asli tribes who were living in the region. So an arrangement was made that, it probably went something like this. You know, the indigenous peoples probably thought that, you know, these foreigners shouldn't govern us. So they came up with this, and the Minang from the Minang side, they probably thought, okay, these are the people already here, and we don't want to upset them too much. So let's come up with a system of power sharing. Although many of the sukus from Sumatra, and as I said, they replicated the same institutions, but there was this new suku called the Suku Biduanda, which only exists in the peninsula, which represented the intermarriages between the original Minang settlers and the Orang Asli who were already on the land. And all the Undangs until today come from the Suku Biduanda. And so it's, whereas the ruler is from the Pagaruyung dynasty, the original Pagaruyung dynasty. So you have representatives of the Minang settlers together with the Orang Asli tribes who elect the ruler. So it's a very interesting form of power sharing.
So when it comes to the present time, is it still relevant? Is the power sharing still existing?
Well, I guess like many traditional institutions, right? And I think many of the original raison d'etre have been not as appreciated as they should be, but I think it's very important that people do know that history because I think it resonates with.
There's some form of democracy within, or power sharing within.
It's both, right? I mean, the idea that the Suku Biduanda was created to represent an alliance between the Minang settlers and the Orang Asli was already a form of power sharing. And then after that, subsequently, for them to elect the ruler took that concept further. But when you talk about democracy, it's still true until today that the Undangs and the Lembagas, which are the people below them so on and so forth, they are all still elected according to the evolved form of adat perpatih that we have in Negeri Sembilan today, in which clan membership is matrilineal, and it's the people who occupy the institutions below who elect the people above.
Mm-hmm. So who consists of the Undang in today's Negeri Sembilan Menak?
Well, there's still four the Undangs, and there's one area called Tampin, which has the Tunku Busa Tampin. He is also considered one of the four, one of the ruling chiefs, so there are five of them.
What about the way the Negeri Sembilan Menak has evolved from the olden times until now? I mean, what is the changing role of the Negeri Sembilan Menak towards its own Negeri Sembilan people?
That's a very deep question. again, I would say that you got to put it in context. The roles, I mean, the roles of the monarch, I mean, the roles of government have changed, right, over the past 200 years. So, when you ask how has the role of the monarch changed, well, you have to look at it in that context, right? I think people's expectations of their government have also changed tremendously over the last 200 years, and the responsibilities of Kerajaan in 1773. I mean, you know, I told you just now the story of protection from foreign powers. I think that was the main responsibility in those days. To ensure, the Raja was there to ensure that the adat and the faith and the culture and the traditions and the, you know, and of the people were not unduly damaged by incursions from foreign powers. Whereas today, I mean, today we have a federal constitutional system in which people have very different expectations of the monarchy. The expectations of the monarchy, I think, to defend and to sort of to be a symbol of the state's unique customs and traditions, that has remained throughout. But I don't think anyone would expect the ruler to play a role in foreign policy. I mean, mm-hmm. And sign treaties.
I think when you talk about legitimacy, it's important to bear in mind that, yes, although our monarchies predate Merdeka by many hundreds of years, the Merdeka arrangement conferred upon the institution democratic legitimacy. I mean, Tunku Abdul Rahman won the general elections of 1955 and again, after Merdeka. So, and subsequently, I mean, these, and every political party today generally upholds what the objectives of Merdeka. And so, this idea that the constitutional arrangement is somehow invalid, I think has no standing, because I think there's a consensus across the political divide now that the constitutional structure that we adopted at Merdeka, which included institutions that predated Merdeka, and again reaffirmed in 1963 with the formation of Malaysia, is something that is acknowledged by both sides.
But what about other roles, like the head of religion, or the in terms of welfare?
Let's take those two things separately. I mean, when you talk about head of Islam, I mean, that's something which was always acknowledged from the very beginning. I think even long before the arrival of the British, certainly. I mean, the idea that we had a Yam Tuan called the Yam Tuan Imam, and the legend is that the reason why he was called Yam Tuan Imam was because he was a deeply religious person himself, and he led prayers in the mosque, and so the idea that and of course, if you look at other states, I mean, in Kedah, for example, you know, why Kedah became a sultanate in 1136 is because the ruler converted to Islam, and when the ruler converts to Islam, generally throughout in the history of our peninsular states, you know, the state, you know,
the people will follow suit.
So, I think the ruler's position as head of Islam has always been there. That's something which has been formalized right up till today. When you talk about welfare, I mean, again,
yeah, like I witness a lot of foundation being started by the royal family.
That's right. That's right. I think that you have to make the distinction between, you know, welfare programs that are initiated by the government, which mm-hmm. are under the purview of government, mm-hmm. and as I said, we have constitutional monarchy, so it's not today for the monarchs to say this particular welfare program should be implemented. That's for government to present in their manifesto, and then if their candidates win at elections, then they carry out the manifesto. And if that includes welfare policies, then that's, you know, that's how the will of the people is sort of translated into policy. But you're right to say that one of the very important roles of the royals today is to lead foundations and to be patrons of foundations and be indeed be actually very active in them. And I know of a few situations where you know, the rulers or their consorts take a very, very keen interest in particular foundations. I mean, and when you talk about foundations, I think there are cases where personal experience really comes into play because, okay, let's take the example of the Tunku Azizah Fertility Foundation. Tunku Azizah is the Tunku Puan Pahang. And, you know, for many years, she, and it's quite, I think it's quite a well-known story, she's talked about it in the media before, that, you know, she had trouble conceiving for many years. And so the foundation, which now bears her name, isn't something, it isn't an afterthought. You know, it's not as if there was a foundation who was looking for a royal patron. It's something that she herself is very much personally invested in. And so that's just one example of how, you know, a personal experience of a, in this case, a consort of the of a Tunku Makota, is able to really shed light on a particular cause, and a very worthwhile cause.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's move on to the role of monarchy in modern Malaysia in general. So, in the state, so the extent of power of today's monarchy, do they control, you know, other areas as well? I mean, other than the one that you mentioned. What about in politics and economy? You know, do they have their power to make decision in those areas as well?
As I mentioned earlier, I mean, we are now a federal constitutional monarchy, and many of the you talk about policy, that is the purview of the elected government of the day, and I don't think, certainly
not just policy, but electing leaders or giving consent to, you know, being elected as well.
Not sure if I get your question. I mean, if the question is,
since Agong is the head of state,
yes.
So do they have? I mean, what is the extent of their power? You know, within the context of Malaysian politics.
I think if you look at the laws of the country, the powers, you know, the rulers do not formulate policy and they do not implement policy. But it's very interesting. It's quite interesting that in recent times, I have to say, there are many groups who do want the monarchs to have a greater hand in policy making, or at least to prevent certain policies from being implemented. I think in the past few years, I mean, you being active in civil society, you know this, right? That there are many groups who have marched and protested and outside the palace and sent memoranda to the palace, pleading with the palace to intervene. And this is actually quite a tricky phenomenon because many people would say, "Oh, their constitutional monarchs should not get involved in decisions like this." And yet, there is a groundswell of people who say that a groundswell of support from people who say that no, the monarchy is the last defense we have, and we plead with them, or we plead with the palace to prevent, you know, XYZ from happening. So you do have that dynamic, and I guess what this phenomenon recognizes is the influence and sort of the unwritten power that a monarch can exercise but it needs to be very well considered because of the constitutional ramifications.
So in a sense that even though people protest or they ask for the monarchy to, you know, to intervene in certain decision making in politics or economy, their power is still constrained, limited.
I think that would be a fair comment, yes. But I would also say that perhaps the rulers do discuss things and are aware of things much more than people might realize. But things need to be done in a constitutional manner. I think that's sort of. I mean, let's take the issue of appointments. I mean, I think a few years ago, there was a senior judicial appointment, and the Conference of Rulers did indeed, and I think this was quite well known at the time, the Conference of Rulers did indeed, within the Constitution, manage to appoint a judge who many people said was better than the one that was originally proposed. Mm-hmm. So there are ways in which the Conference of Rulers can act within the Constitution while still responding to popular opinion.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this is just a personal question of mine. There's different laws towards the monarchy, and the rest of the society will have to go under the civil law or the Sharia law. But in your own opinion, do you think the monarchs and the rest of the citizens should be subjected under similar laws?
I mean, in this country, we've long had the concept of rule of law. I mean, I always say that we have our own Magna Carta many people would say the contract between Sri Tribhuwana and Demang Labadawan was our Magna Carta. I think the Batu Bersurat Terengganu of 1303 is a better example of our Magna Carta. And what it shows is that the ruler is subject to the law. And that has, I think that's always been true. I mean, even at Merdeka, I think you're referring to certain immunities, for example. But yeah. I think it's normal. It's not unusual for heads of state anywhere in the world to be granted some level of immunity. It doesn't contravene the principle of rule of law. The idea of protecting senior office holders from certain legal proceedings is to protect the sanctity of the institution.
So on the state of Malaysia's politics, and you being a Malay person and also a person from the Negeri Sembilan Monarch, do you see the importance of monarchy playing a more active role in politics? I mean, you yourself have been playing a more active role in politics. And I think a few, if you look at the monarchs in other states as well, they've been playing quite an active role in politics as well, especially concerning our political system has been very much racial and religious based in terms of the sentiment. Do you think they should play a larger role in dismantling the race and religion-based politics in this country?
I think I'll repeat what I said earlier, right? Government policy is a matter for government. And if you ask me...
Perhaps in civil society.
Well, no, but we touched on the role of foundations just now, but... look, the rulers are present in many other fields of Malaysian life, right? They're colonels in chief of military regiments. They are chancellors of universities. They are active in sports, and many charitable initiatives, cultural initiatives. I mean, I think in these ways, the rulers offer their sort of a moderating force for the rest of society. And I mean, I've seen for myself how the presence of a monarch at, let's say at a foundation event, right? And I think that it's hugely meaningful to the people involved. And in fact, 2 weeks ago, I did a talk at the Rotary Club of Kuala Lumpur, Diraja, which is the only Rotary Club in the world which has royal patronage.
Oh, really?
In this case, from the Sultan of Selangor. Oh. And they are so proud of that. This is the Rotary Club of Kuala Lumpur, Diraja. I think many people sometimes are quite cynical about royal patronage. It's just that they're looking for, they want certain things. But actually, the fact that you have a ruler there, I think is much more meaningful than just being the name. And of course, you have situations where a monarch has their own personal interest. I mean, the previous Yang Dibudwan Agong, Sultan Mizan of Terengganu, is an equestrian. And so he brought that, he did, by virtue of him being an equestrian, sort of elevated the sport in a particular way. The previous Sultan of Terengganu, Sultan Ismail Nasiruddin Shah, was an avid photographer. Mm-hmm. And many enthusiasts today credit him as being the father of modern photography in Malaysia.
Oh, that's interesting.
And then, of course, in the case of almarhum Sultan Azlan Shah of Perak, And many people, of course, remember his contributions to the law. But he was also a key figure in the development of hockey in this country. So, you know, these are just some ways in which the rulers have, you know, outside the outside their roles of being heads of state, you know, there are many other aspects of Malaysian life where contributions have been made.
Okay, let's take a break now and we will return back with more discussion on monarchy, also in Southeast Asia.
The voice of Sherry.
Hi, this is Arlene and we are returning back with our guest here, Tunku Zain Al-Abidin Ibnu Tuanku Mukris. He'll be continuing our discussion about monarchy in Southeast Asia. So in ASEAN, there are also quite a number of monarchy that is still existing. I mean, the best example is Thailand and Brunei. And in their case, in Thailand's case, for example, the monarchy is considered something as a person that is of a divine, have a divine power, meaning that they are above the law. While in Brunei, the monarchy actually take full control of the politics and economy of the country. So what is your view on the role of monarchy in the modern ASEAN countries?
Well, look, one of the things which I always begin when I talk about ASEAN, you know, at conferences, etc., is the fact that in ASEAN we have 10 countries which have very different political systems.
Very different.
And so I think that's something we have to recognize. And I'm you know, I think it's a matter, frankly, for the Thais or the Bruneians to have their own view about how their government, you know, about their own political system. But it's true that monarchies exist. You know, there are other monarchies outside Malaysia. Yeah, but what I would say is that constitution, you know, and monarchies indeed are can be very different. I mean, you have and indeed, even within constitutional monarchies, you have some monarchies where, which are very much like the British style, where the monarch is almost purely ceremonial. You have other systems, such as Liechtenstein, for example, where the monarch has executive power but has a democratic mandate. So I think it's very difficult to say that, you know, all monarchs or even all constitutional monarchs have equal, you know, have a similar amount of power. But interestingly, many of the world's best democracies are also constitutional monarchies. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something which we in Malaysia should take heart from, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if you look at countries, such as the UK, you know, Sweden, Norway, Australia, Japan, New Zealand, Canada, you know, these are all monarchies which are also very successful democracies. And I think we in Malaysia should look at that and say that and I think that the founding fathers of our country, had that model in mind to be a successful constitutional monarchy together with the parliamentary democracy.
In the Malaysian context, in the modern Malaysian context, how do you think the Malaysian monarch can play an important role in the public spheres and stay relevant in the eyes of our multicultural nation?
I think, in conclusion, many of the things we've touched on today, for example, the role of the monarch's presence in civil society through foundations, through charities, through cultural initiatives, through sporting initiatives, through university life, through military life. I mean, I think these are all important parts of Malaysian life that have benefited from the contributions of the monarchs, whether directly or indirectly. And I think that's, as long as that remains true, then the institution should be able to flourish.
Mm-hmm. And I'd like to touch on your personal view on our country's political system. I mean, you have been an avid writer in terms of writing about the country's politics. What is your view on our national policy and in relation to the economic policy?
Just now you mentioned about royals being involved in politics. So let me just deal with that because I didn't answer that just now. So on the issue of royals being involved in politics, as you mentioned, I think it's very important to make the distinction between the actual monarchs, the actual heads of state with their constitutional roles, against individuals who have chosen to enter party politics. And of course, there have been five that I know of, five children of monarchs. I mean, if you look at wider family members, there's been quite a few, but there are five children of rulers who have been involved in politics. Tunku Abdul Rahman, our father of independence, who was son of the Sultan of Kedah, and Tunku Abdullah, my great uncle, who was son of our first Yang Di Putuan Agong, Tunku Abdul Rahman, a son of the Raja of Perlis, the son of the Sultan of Pahang, and also the son of Sultan of Terengganu. And in fact, he still is active in politics, Tunku Paduka Sri Raja. He was active in Semangat 46, now he's active, and now he's in PAS. So there are individuals who have been active in politics, but I think there's an important distinction to make. The constitutional role of the head of the ruler is very clear, but you know, his family members, you know, do other things and they have careers and they have jobs. And if sometimes it might be politics. So I think it's very clear to make that distinction. Now,
the last one.
My view on policy. My view on government policy. I think, you know, I'm involved in, I have my other platforms. You know, I have I'm founding president of Ideas, and we, you know, I think, we do a lot of work in this area. It's nothing to do with the fact that with who I am. I think as a citizen, like any other citizen, you know, we all have the right to voice our opinions, and it's, you know, I would make the point that, you know, my column, you mentioned my writing. I started writing before my father became ruler.
Oh.
So that was, you know, that was something I did, and it's something I still continue to do as a citizen of Malaysia. Now, no doubt, many other platforms and opportunities have been given to me in the past few years, but I think it's nonetheless my continued objective to share my views with whoever is interested in reading them.
So, Tunku, what do you do outside of your work as the founding president of Ideas?
Well, actually, in terms of Ideas, I don't do very much day-to-day. That's mainly Wan Sai Ful and Trisha Yeo. I'm still a board member. I still attend some meetings and I give a few speeches from time to time. But outside of Ideas, I mean, I'm involved in three foundations as a trustee. So I'm a trustee of Yayasan Chowkit, which has centres for stateless and refugee children. You should interview Tini Zainuddin if you haven't already done so. And I mean, that has a very important ASEAN angle, because a lot of the refugees are from Myanmar. So there's Yayasan Chowkit. I'm a trustee of Yayasan Munara, which is the royal foundation in Negeri Sembilan, and amongst the things that we do there is help children to go into university. The other foundation I'm involved in is the Jeffrey Chow Foundation, which owns the Sunway Education Group. So Sunway College, Sunway University. So I'm involved there. I'm involved, you know, I'm a director of a couple of companies, advising, you know, and mostly educational. So there's one private college I'm involved in. There's one, robotics educational robotics company, which,
I'm helping out, which is really cool. Fascinating. The idea there is to try and get STEM education, so science, technology, education, and maths, into schools and improve STEM education through educational robotics. What else? I'm patron of a few musical and cultural things. So
and you can play a few musical instruments.
Well, 2 weeks ago there was the Eurasia Youth Music Festival, sort of an initiative of a music teacher in Srumban, and she asked me to be patron for the second year running. So I said yeah, and this time I performed with the kids. Selamat Pergi Pahlawanku by Datuk Johari Saleh. And so I performed that piano on the piano, and then the kids were on strings. But actually, every year for the past 4 years, I've been playing at UKM, at the UKM Concert Diraja, because my Tuanku, the Yang Diputan Besar, is the Chancellor of UKM. So they have this Concert Diraja every year, and they always ask me to play. I think this is because 5 years ago, I did this project for the state anthem. With the MPO, and we reorchestrated the anthem. So I think from then people thought that was kind of musical. So that's how that thing started. But one initiative which I'm really quite keen on is there's this association led by a former police chief in Perak called the Wira Association, and what they've asked me to do is to help them revive the tradition of commemorating our war dead. So at Tugu, various monuments around the country, to try and, you know, bring veterans, but also importantly bring young Malaysian school children to come and see and understand why our soldiers and, you know, many volunteers as well gave up, sacrificed their lives to defend this country. So last year we did one at the Gemenche Bridge. This is where a group of Commonwealth soldiers managed to halt the Japanese advance for a few days. A few days, but they sacrificed many lives of sacrifice there. And we need to understand that principles and values were being defended. And especially during the emergency as well. I mean, and what really concerns me now is that even these relatively recent incidents are being reinterpreted for contemporary political reasons. And it's important to understand that, you know, the communist insurgency was not something that was primarily racial. It was ideological. And political ideology in this country perhaps is often left by the wayside. You know, people, I think, and you see that in both political parties today, right? There are people trying to be pragmatic with no sort of ideological base from which they draw their policies. It's sort of,
it's a very short-term sort of.
Very short-term, exactly right, mm-hmm. Yeah. And on top of that, of course, then there is all the stuff I have in Negeri Sembilan. So obviously when it's Tuanku's birthday in January, I'm in Negeri Sembilan a lot. There are lots of ceremonies and there are lots of events that happen around that time, which we have to attend. And of course now Ramadan is coming up. So during Ramadan, typically we'll be going to a lot of the different kampungs and having buka puasa with the local communities. And then even outside those times, every Friday, I try and go back to join my father for prayers. Every week, he'll go to a different mosque. And I think in the state, and I think this is a hugely, hugely educational for me to be able to go to communities where life is, you know, it's amazing how you can drive 1 hour or, you know, 1 hour, 1.5 hours from KL to a rural part of Negeri Sembilan. And it's a completely different lifestyle. And I think, it, you know, for many urbanites, all these hipsters sometimes, I include myself as a very, you know, it's very easy to live in the Bangsa bubble, you know, or the, and it sort of brings you back down to earth to be able to go every week to to a different rural part of my state and to witness different values at work and different lifestyles. And I mean, this being an ASEAN station, I think I should mention that I'm quite interested in the region. I'm still I'm also a research fellow at CIMB, ASEAN Research Institute, and trying to see what, for example, the ASEAN Economic Community do at the end of next year when Malaysia is the chair of ASEAN. You know, see what that means for the region and what it means for local politics. I think very often, if you step out and look at us from a regional perspective, many of the issues that we get so upset about, we need to deal with them because we are trying to compete in a wider setting.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, thank you very much. It was interesting that you share with us a lot of your view on our monarchy and how they fit well into today's modern Malaysia.
Thank you. Had fun.